Hey guys, and welcome to another video of this beginner guide series. I'm Exterminator, and I am here again with MadZuri. Oh, here we go. Little bit of lag. So, how are you doing?
I'm good, and thank you, Autosave.
Sure. Yeah, thank you, Save. Lagging us out here. Alright, so this episode, I know last time we said we were going to do science, but that can't really be done very well without automated smelting, so we're going to go ahead and set up some smelting here. And there's many different ways you can do it. And we're going to go with a build here that works pretty well all the way up until you need to upgrade to electric furnaces from these stone furnaces. And yeah, we'll kind of explain it as we go here. Zuri can definitely explain it pretty well. So, we're just setting up some miners. You can separate them out if you want. The only thing that's really going to achieve is just not letting the resource patch get mined out quite as quickly. But since the map is infinite and we have trains and stuff later on, it's not that big of a deal to just space them right next to each other.
Yeah, we're going to empty out this patch anyway, so it doesn't really matter how fast we do it.
Yeah, exactly. So now we just need to connect some power up. Power's way over here. Alright.
When building smelters, I like to start with the output belt first and then work around it. So I'm just going to pick a random spot and go down.
Okay. Yeah, so this is definitely a good way to do it, because if you try to build your smelter thing first and then get the output belt in here, or the input as well, either way, it can get a little messy. Alright, so so how this is going to work is we're going to, as you can see, Zuri's just putting furnaces on each side here, and our smelted plate is going to go onto this middle belt, and then the ore and the coal that we're going to need are going to go on some outside belts, which you'll see in a minute. And do you want to go over some of the benefits of this setup, maybe over compared to some others?
Sure. You first of all, you can only get as many belts out as you put in, so we're going to feed this with one belt ore, and it's going to have one belt plates coming out. And I like to put the output in the middle, because you don't have to worry about any kind of belt balancing. It's just inherently balanced. You don't ever have to worry about it. And since there'll be a splitter up here, it'll make it so the left and right side get even amounts of ore. So you don't even have to worry about it. It's just inherently balanced, which I consider is better design.
Right. Yeah, definitely, because otherwise you might try doing some belt balancers and stuff, which can pretty easily mess stuff up. If it's not done correctly, that is.
Yeah, it'll save yourself a lot of headache if you just don't even worry about it.
Sweet. So now we just need a splitter up here before these two lines to get our coal and our iron in, and we're going to do, see how Zuri wants to do it here. There's several ways you can merge this in, for sure.
Oh, look, I knew which way you want to do it.
Alright, so, yeah, there's a couple ways here. Essentially, we could either just put a splitter here and bring these lines down like so. If the game will stop lagging a little bit. And if we wanted, we could merge things on via a mechanic called side loading, where you run one belt into another one. This is probably not the best way to do it, so I'm going to do it a different way in a minute, but just to show, this is one way you could do it, have like the iron come onto one side and the coal come onto another, but I don't think this is a very good way to do it. So another method we could use is to still use splitters here, but to... actually going to need to push this out a little bit. Is to do something like this, because there's still side loading, but I think it's potentially maybe a little bit better. And definitely correct me if I'm wrong here.
No, that's good.
So we get the iron coming in here, and then we're just going to use an underground belt, which allows us to go underneath things, to bring our coal over to this side, and then it's just automatically going to be separated, split perfectly evenly here once we actually get our coal over here. So you're definitely going to end up having a lot of belts running all over your base, which, I mean, if you're super OCD, it can be maybe a problem, but you can clean it up later, and it's kind of just unavoidable unless you just majorly plan stuff out, like, way far ahead.
I never crafted enough inserters for this.
You said you didn't?
Well, I'm crafting some now, but I keep forgetting that.
Yeah, I have a few, but I didn't make enough either.
I've got a ton of belt in case you need it.
Oh, actually, I think I barely have enough, actually. So, I guess we could go over some simple ratios here. So do you happen to know that for this smelting setup, how many coal miners we might need to supply it without going like way overkill?
It's pretty close to 1 to 2. As in, it's not exactly, but close enough. One miner will feed 2 stone furnaces.
Right. Yeah, so that is definitely a good ratio to keep in mind for stuff that a miner will feed 2 stone furnaces. Now, once you get your steel ones, which are the next level up, I believe it is pretty much a 1 to 1. Maybe not exactly, but because the steel furnaces smelt twice as fast as a stone.
Yeah, so we have 20 smelters here, so we need about 10 miners, and we have, I think, 11?
1, 2, 3.
No, we have 9. We need 2 more.
Right. So obviously the ore is all backed up, and that's just because we don't have our coal in here yet. Once we do get that, it's going to fill up, and we're going to get a ton of iron plate coming in. And then you can just pretty much copy this for copper. It won't need to be as big as we went over last time. You don't need nearly as much copper in this early stage as you do iron.
And we can expand this if you wanted.
Right. Yeah, which is very important, because then if you don't build it expandable, then you just end up tearing it down every time you want to change it, and that can become a huge pain. Now, I'm not sure if 2 miners for coal is going to be enough for this. Perhaps. And something else really quick to go over that might confuse some newer people is that furnaces and assembling machines, they will only stock a certain number of a resource that they need. So you can see this furnace is only going up to 2 two iron ore and only so much coal. Some people get confused by this and think that something's wrong, but they will only stock up to a certain amount of what they need.
So and one of the biggest...
Go ahead.
Sorry. New problems I see sometimes is they're concerned that, like, the furnace or the assembly machine isn't working. And it's usually because the output inserter can't put it anywhere, and it fills up the inside and stops. And they just see that it stops. So
yep.
You should...
Yep.
These will fill up, and then they'll stop.
Yeah, very good point. So, they have an internal storage. The smelters at least have an internal storage for a completed product of 100 or a stack. So once they reach that, they're just going to stop. If there's no way for the output inserted to export the finished good. So now we can probably just do another smaller version of this for copper.
You want me to build it right where I'm standing?
Yeah, right next to it. That's probably good. And how much copper would you say we probably need for now?
About half of this for now, but we should build it expandable.
Right, yeah. Yeah, so we're just essentially just copying this exact design here. And we're just going to really only use half, even if we want to. We could build it all the way out if we wanted and just only use half of it, but it's really just up to you. So now we just need to figure out where do we want to get our copper from. You want to try to grab it from this little teeny one up here to the north that we're using?
Yeah, let's mine that out. And it looks like that should have been a really huge copper patch, but a lake landed in the middle of it.
Yeah, you're right. I think it definitely looks like something happened there. And I probably don't want to build entirely over that oil patch there. I guess we haven't really gone over oil. Oil is different than the other resources in terms of how it works. Let's see here. So, I mean, if you want to go over kind of the difference of oil.
Sure. Oil slowly decreases its yield. If it says 100%, it starts off at 1 per second, and I can get very complicated into the equation for the decay, but I'll skip that for now and just say eventually it'll decay down to 0.1 per second.
Right. Yep, exactly. So so for this one over here, for example, that I'm looking at, it's 248%, so it's going to be, well, 2.48. You're not going to see the 8 there when you actually put a pump on it, but almost 2.5 a second, and then it's just slowly going to wear down. So oil is essentially infinite because it never actually completely runs out, but once you hit 0.1, it's really slow going. So again, we're just grabbing, tapping this iron patch or this copper patch entirely, and we have how many miners do we have? 5, which should be enough to support 10 furnaces, which is exactly what we have here.
That may have been planned.
Yeah, exactly. So now I'm not really sure that 2 coal miners will be enough to support all this. Let's see here. So once you get all your automated smelting up, then you can really head into automating science, because you're obviously not going to want to do it like we have over here the entire time, unless you just want to spend like a ridiculous amount of time doing research. Let's see here. And, wow, going all over the place with belt. So, let's see, we already went over side loading and splitters here in undergrounds. I mean, you'll probably figure this out on your own. Undergrounds can go a space of 4. And you can grab from them at the openings and the, well, at both openings, the entrance and exit here. You can grab from them with an inserter. Obviously, you can't grab from anywhere else because it's gone underground, but you can grab from it at these entrances, which can be really, really useful. Alright, so I think we're about ready for science, don't you?
Yeah, we are. That's about all you need.
Awesome, so we're like 16 minutes. We could probably start on the science build if you want.
Sure.
Alright, so Zuri has a really nice science build he's going to show us here that will pretty much last you for most of the game, as long as you upgrade the assembling machines and stuff appropriately.
There's a forest in the way.
Yeah, which it is really unfortunate. There's a few mods that you can get that will help clear things out, but so I assume we kind of want to do like a main bus type design is what we're going to go for.
That's probably a good idea.
Right, so a main bus, I mean, there's many different ways to build a factory. Obviously, you can just do it just however you want and make it all like spaghetti belt, which may not be the most efficient, but it's can be kind of fun. So, but what we're going to do is a main bus, where essentially we just send our primary resources down the middle. You'll see better as we go. And then we just split them off as we need them and build our subproducts off to the side, and then if needed put the products back on the bus if it's something that we want on there. The main bus does have some throughput issues later on, doesn't it, Zuri?
That's why I like to do what we call a production bus.
Okay.
If you would space these out a little more and do up to 4 lines of each.
Right.
So I suppose I should give a little more room for that to happen.
Yeah, probably a good idea. Right, so if the smelting line's gonna come down to here. So yeah, if you plan it out, you can end up having 4 lines of iron and 4 lines of copper, and that may seem like way overkill, but once you really get later into the game, depending how you scale your production, it will definitely be needed.
These fast deserters are really tempting. I really want to build them.
Oh yeah, go for it. I mean, these normal inserters are pretty pathetic. So we have, there's 5 different types of inserters in the game. We already went over the burner ones. The inserters are pretty much like a burner, except that they obviously take power. And you can see the speed they move at. Fast inserters move a lot faster, and then the long-handed can reach an extra space. I'm not sure we've used those yet. But they can reach an extra space. So, for example, a long-handed could reach a belt that is out here. And then same with the output, is it can output to an extra space, so it could output one over here. And we'll let Zuri go over this build here.
So we're going to start off with building gears and putting it on a belt and then side-loading copper onto the same belt, and I'm still handcrafting a bunch of stuff.
Right.
But that's all you basically need for it.
Here, I'll give you some assembling machines since you're going to set this up.
Basing it off of a base crafting speed of 1 per second. And since red science takes 5 seconds, it takes 5 machines to build it.
Yep. And just in case we weren't clear last time, the science pack ones, these red science packs, take a copper plate and an iron gear wheel. So we already had the copper, and we have iron. So the gear wheel is like a next step up from these products, right? Because it takes iron plate to make. So it's just like, I guess, would be like an intermediate product. So red science is pretty simple. Green science gets a bit more complicated. And then blue science is just gonna make you go nuts.
Oh, blue science is fun.
Maybe for some people, it still drives me nuts even now.
You might want to cover copy-pasting.
Right, yeah. So you're copy-pasting. I mean, you can go over that if you want.
So you can hold shift and right-click to copy in something out of a machine, the metadata technically, and then shift left-click to copy it. So I don't have to open up the inventories.
Yeah, exactly. So, like normally, just so you can see on my screen, so normally you would have to go in here and click the little icon and select it, but you saw Zuri just running down and all the machines changed to the same thing. That's just super, super handy. And you can do it with other stuff too, which we'll get into later. And now you want these output towards the back here, right?
Yes.
Alright. So I believe what we're going to have done here is we're going to have red and green share a belt here, so the green is going to be put onto the belt from this other side.
Yes.
So yeah, this is a really nice little compact build, which makes it pretty simple. I'll just stand here for a minute for anyone to look at it. You can just bring the iron down, and as you can see, the inserter can grab from a corner here, if you were curious, and yeah. And then one thing I guess we didn't really go over is that inserters have a very specific behavior with how they work. They will always output onto the far side of a belt. You can see here, this guy's always putting on this far side, and that's important because when we go to side load this copper, it's going to go on this close side, so we can have two resources on one belt, two different resources. So this is a good behavior to keep in mind, that these guys will always export onto the outside of a belt, and that can make things easier when you're trying to get two different resources onto a belt.
We have any science labs, so we can start pretty much plowing through research now that red's done.
Right. So I'm going to make a few. I'm going to go grab these ones that we've already set up here. And it's a little dark, so I've made some lights, which you just get by researching optics, which we did off screen here, but throw some lights down, grab these science labs. So we were talking earlier, what was like a good number of science labs to aim for, did you say, Zuri?
20 sounds about right. If you want to go slow and you don't worry about eating it as much, 10 will do you. Or up to 30. I think 20 is a nice round number to stick to.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely a good way to do it. So yeah, essentially it'll be doing it 20 times faster than if you just had one, or 19, one of the others. So that can definitely speed things up, and this setup here should supply those 20 labs, pretty much. Wow, I ran out of ammo completely. Pretty much the whole game, as long as you upgrade them appropriately. And I think we're probably out of time here. We're about 25 minutes in.
Okie dokie. We can't finish the build anyway because we don't have the next level of tech.
Right. And we'll go over that next episode about what he's mentioning there, needing the next level assembling machines for this. But we're actually being attacked here. Oh dear. We're really being attacked. I'm out of ammo. So I guess we'll close out the video here dealing with this attack. You can see the biters destroyed our stuff. There's actually quite a large amount of them. So these are what the enemies look like. And this amount would actually probably kill you if we weren't playing multiplayer here. If we weren't two people.
Nice.
Wow. See, that's why it's good to explore, because right now you can see we don't see any bases on our map, so I'm not really sure where that came from.
Oh, it's just a scouting party. They'll start at the 1 hour mark. It's almost exactly on time.
Oh, really? Just like every time?
Well, the algorithm starts at the 1 hour mark, and guess how long we've been playing about?
Yeah, about an hour. Wow, interesting. Yeah, see, so I definitely didn't know that. That's definitely a good thing to keep in mind. But yeah, I think that's going to be it, guys. So as always, thank you for watching. Hope you found this helpful. And next time we will finish our science setup and then move on that from there. So thanks again for joining me, Zuri.
Not a problem. We got a lot of fix, so.
Oh, yeah. Alrighty, so we will see you next time.